Pozdravljeni kolegice in kolegi tukaj na inštitutu in pozdravljeni tudi kolegice in kolegi, ki nas gledate, bi rekla, preko Zoom povezave. Zelo sem vesela in lahko rečem tudi ponosna, da danes gostimo na inštitutu dr. Rubina Zemona, našega dolgoletnega prijatelja, preka tudi profesorja iz Skopja, njegove življenjepis, od njegovih številnih dejavnosti ste lahko prebrali. Vedno je bil vpet, tudi na nek način z nami sodeloval preko akademske mreže, z kolegom Mitjem Žagarjem in pa tudi z kolegom Miranom Komacem. In danes je resnično prilika, da je tukaj med nami in da nam predstavi zelo, ne bom se spuščala v podrobnosti, zelo, rekla, zanimivo predavanje, tudi z zanimivim naslovom North Macedonia, Macedonia between melting pot and salad bowl. Challenges, practices and experiences on managing the diversity society in Northern Macedonia. Predavanje bo v angleškem jeziku, tako da besedo predajam zdaj, govori, ne, kolegu Rubinu. Izvolite.
Hvala, Sonja, direktor instituta. I will continue in English, eh?
Ja, next day.
Okay, so
Lahko tudi, mislim, ne, najbolje v angleščini, ne?
it's my big pleasure to be today here in Ljubljana in the Institute of Ethnic Studies. I am first time in Institute, not first time in Ljubljana. We had some meetings in the last 5 years, I think, with the Friedrich Ebert Stiftung, and that's very important round tables that your institute organized, especially with my friend Mitja, and of course Miran and other friends here. I want to congratulate for the former work that you had here in this, especially on cooperation that we had in Southeast Europe. Even for me, that was very strange, especially yesterday when we actually had the one anniversary of the Yaitse Yugoslavia. And so on. But tomorrow we have another anniversary. I think the 1st December was when the Kingdom of Yugoslavia, I think, was created, but it's now, of course, it's a past. We were in one state, unfortunately. That state was collapsed in a very bloody way. Now we are independent states, and I hope that, of course, our cooperation is very fruitful because we are very familiar. We know each other much more closer than other, let's say, European states. However, it's my pleasure. I will sit because I have PowerPoint here. And because always my presentations are interactive. So we agree with Sonia that it will be 1 hour presentation. Always it's 40 minutes with 20 minutes questions. But however, I want always to be interactive. So anytime you can break me in to ask me something,
Yeah, it's better than
it's
that.
better, I think, with that way. But we must all together caring for 1 hour. That's it.
Yes.
Also, I want to say hello to participants in the Zoom. Also, I see some friends, they are following us, and I hope that they will follow very well the PowerPoint presentation. So when we are talking about North Macedonia and this topic, between the melting pot and salad bowl, probably you are very familiar with these two terms. Melting pot is one of the concept of managing. Actually, it's not managing of diversity, but it's much more managing of assimilation. In one state, it was very, how to say, not popular, but there were politics in the 20th century, especially when nation state came in the stage and the politics that in one territory, it must be one nation, one language, one religion, and so on. And of course, that was not actually 19th century, but the 20th century, according to the inertia, it was one kind of politics of melting pot. But as you know, later in the second half of 20th century, the so-called politics of salad bowls, actually, of not melting, but all diversities to be in one bowl and to be respected, but again, to be in one unit. So today also in Europe, not only in Europe, but generally in the world, we have different approaches to this managing of diversity. And Macedonia, of course, it's, you will see, according to me and some scholars, is, has a very big challenge about how to manage diversity, especially at the beginning. I will just give a short introduction of what was happening in Macedonia from independence to date. The main process is not the whole history, but just to have one overview, and later maybe we'll discuss. Okay. Yes. So after the independence of Republic of Macedonia, the referendum was in 8 September 1991. Actually, it was the process that was in whole Yugoslavia, first started in Slovenia here. I think it was on 25 June something, yes. 25 June 1991, later in Croatia and so on. And actually the same question, it was in Croatia, in Slovenia, it was also in Macedonia for the referendum. That maybe in Macedonia later was a reason for some problems. Even today we have some problems, bearing in mind what's going on with the relation between Macedonia and Bulgaria. So I will use Macedonia, even that I was a member of the parliament, I voted the change of the name to North Macedonia. But however, in its official name, of course, North Macedonia, but in everyday using, we are using Macedonia. So if you don't mind, I will use Macedonia, but however, we may use the bold. I am using the bold term, actually, depend on the situation. Even that some people in Macedonia now are very angry when somebody is using North Macedonia, but that's the reality, and probably we will live with that reality very, very long time. So actually the main person of the independence was Kiril Grigorov, the president, the first president of Macedonia. You know, he was one person from ex-Yugoslavia, one of the main communist leader during Yugoslavia, one of the very close cooperator advisor of Josip Broz Tito. Also, he was one person who made one of the economic reformers in 1960s, I think something. And it was actually one figure that was really also famous in Macedonia. And he was like the first president, and he built actually the politics of so-called Macedonia to be the oasis of peace, because actually in Croatia, happened in Croatia, in Bosnia, and later in Kosovo. Of course, his declaration and politics was that we will make the independence without firing even a bullet in Macedonia. But of course, it was very unstable, because it was very unstable because of Macedonia. Actually, it's a very diverse society. Around 65% are ethnic Macedonians, and the others are around 20-25% are Albanians, and the others are, we have the Turks, we have Serbians, we have Vlachs, Romanians, we say also, but Vlachs is generally no one in the Balkans. Roma, of course, and Bosniaks. This, that I mentioned actually now in mentioned a preamble constitution, and unfortunately Slovenians, Croats and Montenegrins, those communities who actually during Yugoslavia were, let's say, constitutional part of the state in Macedonia, they during the night became the minority, even not recognized minority. We don't have recognition, not recognized, but not mentioning and not being joined the rights as this other that are mentioned constitution are. They have the rights. Also, I'm the member of the one community of Balkan Egyptian. The identity of Balkan Egyptian was very well proclaimed during the collapsing of Yugoslavia, actually, and dissolution of Yugoslavia. But that's another question. So also we had not only Egyptian, but other minorities in the Balkans generally appeared in a public, not to be appeared as created, but appeared in a public, especially after the collapse of the communism, because during the communism, they didn't have maybe so much possibilities to affirm their identity in the public. So today also we have some other communities, that, for example, Ashkaris in Kosovo, and Beash is here, I think, in Croatia. Mira knows very well. And of course, it was one changing, you know, very well regarding we'll speak about the identity changing, about the Bosniaks. So in Bosnia, the last census, 1991, we had almost 2 million Muslims with capital M. And Bosniaks were around 3,000 in the last census in Yugoslavia, but now we have vice versa, more than 3 million, I think, in Bosnia and Herzegovina, Bosniaks, and Muslim with capital M are a few thousand. So, of course, it's an issue of identity, but we don't want to speak about it maybe later. And of course, the main problem in Macedonia, when you talk about Macedonia multicultural society, is the issue of the Albanian community. Albanian community, we always have to see in a wider context, not only with Macedonia, we must also see what's going on in Kosovo with this issue, because actually the war that was happening in Macedonia in 2001, it was one kind of consequences of inertia from Kosovo to Macedonia. And in 1997, actually, we had one very big issue about the education, higher education of the Albanian community in Macedonia. And in that time, actually, Macedonia was in the age of the civil war. In 1996, also, it's happened. 95, sorry, it was happened this attempt for assassination of Kiril Grigorov. Until now, we don't know who made the assassination. Nobody takes responsibility for this assassination, the trial for assassination, and even the prosecutors didn't file nobody. Nobody's accused until now. So almost 25 years, we don't have any information what has happened in that September, I forget which date, September 1995. But it's not important only the assassination, it was important that after that, Kiril Grigorov is losing the power, actually, and is coming a new structure from the same political party, Social Democrats, new generation led by Branko Crvenkovski, who basically come. It then was also the prime minister, but he get the much more the power, political power there. And because Macedonia wasn't actually in a reality oasis of peace, the proof is that from 1993, we had the United Nations peace forces there, actually, blue helmets, that's right, blue helmets. And they were actually keeping the border between Macedonia and Serbia, especially in the part in Kosovo. And you know, maybe you don't know, but when it's coming in 1998, it's coming to the change of the government. Actually, the right wing Bomrda Pamunia is taking the power with Ljupčo Georgijevski, and Vasil Tuporkovski, also one very famous politician during the Yugoslavian time. Actually, he was a member of the presidency of Federal Yugoslavia. They actually made hazard move. They recognized Taiwan. Taiwan, you know, the island in China, which China is not recognizing, but the United States and other Western countries are recognizing Taiwan and so on. Macedonia recognized Taiwan. That implicated actually China to give the veto for the continuation of the mission of the United Nations for protection of the border. And from 2000, there was no anymore the United Nations forces in line with the Kosovo. You know very well 1991 started the war in Kosovo, and 2000 and 2001 the border was very fluctuated there, and of course some of the, we'll see later, some of the soldiers of UÇK, of Liberal Army of Kosovo, they freely entered into Macedonia. But we'll discuss maybe later about that. Yes, this is that. From 2000, actually, what has happened with Macedonia before 2001? Macedonia was defined as a national state of Macedonians, and Albanians and other communities were national minorities. Even though Macedonia signed the Framework Convention 1998 for protection of national minorities, ratified 2001, no, ratified immediately 1998, but the first report was given 2002. So actually in a fourth, in reality was later. So from 2001, with the civil war that was happening in Macedonia, these leaders of the Macedonian military, let's say Albanian leaders in led by Ali Ahmeti, he is Ali Ahmeti. Actually, a few months it was a civil war. Some hundred people also were killed, right, and so on. And in, but maybe it was not a very open war. It's much more violent war, very controlled war. But it's another question. Maybe we'll discuss later. In August 17, actually, was signed the so-called Ohrid Framework Agreement. And Macedonia is entering a new phase, we call it Ramkovna, Okvirna Macedonia, Frame It Macedonia. And in that, actually, with this new politics, let's say, or with the new agreement, Macedonia is becoming constituted. We had some constitutional changes, of course. It's not anymore the state of Macedonian nation, but it's a citizen state. We are mentioning some part of the peoples, narodi peoples. Of course, Macedonians are not part, but Albanians, Turks, Serbs, Roma, Bosniaks, Vlachs are part of the peoples, and the others. The others, again, are discriminated, Slovenians, Croats, Egyptians, Bulgarians, now also it's a big issue with the Bulgarians, Greeks, Russians, we have some Ukrainians, Armenians, and never mind. And but what are the real changes? We have power sharing. So the governmental power is not sharing, especially with the so-called equitable representation. It's just one of the, we'll see also later, one of the amendments of the constitution. And according to the percentage of the minority of communities in state bodies and in public institutions have to be representatives of the communities. And of course, the main role actually have the Albanian community. And even that in a constitution, in a law, we have one kind of multicultural, development of multicultural state and the spirit is to develop intercultural communication. In a reality, we'll see later, actually, we have bi-ethnical politics. And that's it, maybe one of the main problems. So, and we have one almost situation where Macedonians are thinking that they are building nation state, Albanians are implementing the politics because this political power of bi-ethnical state, even they are maybe going to the federalization, because some of the now requests that we have for new constitutional changes are giving the signals that they are going to the realization. And all other communities are dreaming for multicultural states in this situation. But from other side, even that the spirit of the Ohrid Framework Agreement is that to build intercultural, multicultural state, in reality, we got a very divided state. Macedonia, especially during the rule of the government of the Nikola Gruevski and Vojislav Dobanomane, they implemented one politic of so-called ethnocracy. You know, the main chief of the tribes are sitting and they are dealing what will go on. So the power is not anymore in the parliament. Parliament became only the institution where it was just technical voting, but the main decision are making this chief of tribes in somewhere, I don't know where, in any place. And according to the result of the technocrats, actually for me. But... Molim? Yeah. And from other state, corruption became very, very big. And corruption is coming, of course, from the high level, from the secret services and so on. And actually, we have ethnocracy and capturing state. The report of the European Unions and other NGOs in 2016-15 saying that Macedonia entered it in a very, let's say, captured and divided society. Captured it and divided society. Unfortunately, with the new government now that we have from 2017, we still have that problem. Nothing has changed. Maybe some symbolical cases have changed, but generally, this is the situation we have. And of course, regarding to the multiculturalism, we still have so-called bi-ethnical and divided society. We'll see later some examples. In 2017, when Zoran Zaev came, some of the intellectuals we sit and we said that we must improve the situation, what's going on with the divided society. And actually, Zoran Zaev had in his campaign during election campaign 2016 that we have to transform to one from divide to one society. And of course, we are thinking about how to build. I was from 2018 advisor of Prime Minister, especially for multicultural society, and we tried to make a new document, new politics, to be one kind of interministerial strategy for improving the situation. Some of the international experts also included Mitya was one of the other review of that strategy. Unfortunately, what Mitya wrote there, it was totally right what was going on with the strategy, but we'll discuss later. But the attempt was that we have to degree the vision and to increase the intercultural communication. Maybe we had some results, we'll discuss later, especially those right wings political parties started to think to make to give the candidates from other communities, especially the Albanians and Macedonians. And they make also some, let's say, coalitions before the election campaign. So it was one kind of, I think, one of the consequences of the strategy, but it's something else. Also, very big problem in Macedonia had in this period, almost 30 years from the independence, it was so-called name issue or name dispute. You know that the state of Greece immediately after the admission contested the name of the state because after the Balkan Wars in 1913 with the Bucharest Treaty, the territory of Macedonia. So actually the state, the big state Macedonia was never exist. but it's one kind of geographical, let's say, territory. It was also during the Ottoman Empire very diverse. But with the Bucharest Treaty, from that geographical, let's say, area, 52% of Macedonia actually was connected, let's say, or annexed to the Kingdom of Greece in that time, 38% to the Kingdom of Serbia, 11% to the Kingdom of Bulgaria at that time, and only few percent to the Albanian state, which was created 2011 and 12 in that time. And this so-called actually the Vardarska Macedonia, Vardar Macedonia, where the Serbian actually kingdom had the territory during the Tito Yugoslavia, had one kind of independence in the federal unit. And that's it actually today, what we know Macedonia. These other parts of Macedonia, the great parts has the Greece. And for that, Greece probably said that will appear as some separatist movement, this territory from Greece to be unified with the northern part and so on. But, you know, Macedonia at that time was very weak. It was not any dangerous. According to Stojan Andov, he was the first president of the parliament from 1991. In his books, now he wrote the memories. Actually, he's saying that it was agreement between Milosevic and Mitsotakis, not this Mitsotakis, but the father of today, prime minister. They are very close friends, and Milosevic probably asked for Mitsotakis until the war in Croatia and Bosnia not to be finished, Greece to contest the independence, the full legitimacy of the Macedonia, and later when he will finish the war with Bosnia and Croatia, then he will again took the part that actually was given to Serbia from the Bucharest Treaty in 1913. But of course, there are other issues for analyzing. Unfortunately, Macedonia were 30 years blockaded to be the member of NATO and European Union. If you remember, in 1992, the first, actually, it was by the entire Commission of Constitutional Judges, actually, and they said that only Slovenia and Macedonia are fulfilling the conditions to be the part of European Union. It was 1991, sorry. But from there, from 1991, Slovenia became independent fully, very soon become a NATO and European Union state. But Macedonia, even today, almost actually 2019, become the NATO state. And we are now waiting also to start the negotiation process. And these two guys downstairs, Zoran Zaev and of the Syriza leader, how was his name? I forget now. Avona?
Tsipras.
Tsipras, sorry. Tsipras, they actually made the agreement, so-called Prespa agreement, and finally find a solution. And today, of course, it's not Macedonia. Another very big process that was happening in Macedonia is actually the identity issue of Macedonians. Even that after the collapsing of the communism and the dissolution of Yugoslavia, all actually, let's say, not all, but the majority of the people in Yugoslavia wanted to see the possibility of maybe they don't have Slavic origins. Croats are thinking about Goths, something, Bosniaks, about Germans, Bosnians, and so on. And of course, in Macedonia is the issue of the heritage of ancient Macedonia and the heritage of Alexander the Great and Philip II. Not only, let's say, scientific scholar issue, but when Gruevski came into power, it became a political issue. So he openly making politics to denying the Slavic origin, not to denying, but to ignore the Slavic origin and to affirm the antique origin. We call it antiquization. Antiquization is a process. He built these big monuments you see today in Skopje. Alexander the Great is, I think, the highest monument in Europe, almost 40 meters is high. But not only this, also many other monuments of antiquization we have in Macedonia. And from other side, we are ignoring the fact that, for example, Cyrille Methodius, San Clemente, San Nando, the very important historical figures of the Slavic identity are from Macedonia. But that was about politics, and also came to one, let's say, confrontation inside the Macedonian people, nation, ethnic ethos. Today, let's say, much more the right wing's political party and politicians are still promoting the ancient origin. The left and the middle are still much more promoting the Slavic origin. But this, let's say, debate is still on the stage, even that with the Prespa agreement Macedonia signed, that will not promote antiquization and antique values. Of course, I'm anthropologist and scholars. I have some other position, but maybe we'll discuss later. Now it's appearing in what a new moment. Probably Bulgaria saw that Macedonia can let some very important identity issue, but of course this problem is not from now. Problem with Bulgaria is, and with Bulgarian identity is very old, almost 150 years. So if you want to understand what is going on now between Bulgaria and Macedonia, you have to be very well informed about the history of this region, especially after the Berlin Congress 1878. And now actually the Bulgarian authorities is asking the history book in Macedonia to be reviewed, actually to put some historical figures and processes in another narrative. And this is the commission now. We have one joint commission between Macedonia and Bulgaria about the textbooks in a school, how the historical figures and event to get a new narrative. And of course, the main problem is the figure of Goce Delchev, who is actually the national hero of Macedonia, but at the same time, it's of course the Bulgarians are saying that he had, you know, just one little side event. During the Ottoman Empire, it was so-called millet system. And the millet system was it was not ethnicities, but religion communities were one kind of, let's say, recognized diversity. The biggest millet or community, it was Orthodox Christians called Rum millet. Rumelia is coming, one of the biggest area in the Ottoman Empire is coming from Urum millet. It's been Romans, Romeis in a Turkish language. In that Orthodox millet actually were Greeks, were Bulgarians, were Serbs, were all the Orthodox. It was not easy. And after the Berlin Congress, and especially some document that was accepted in the Ottoman Empire, especially the Hatshepsut and Gilhan Hatshepsut and Hatihumian, when they give the rights to the communities to express their religion rights. Actually, some of the states that was after the Berlin Congress get the independence, so Serbia, Bulgaria, and Greece, they acting in the Ottoman Empire through the so-called church propaganda. And of course, the Bulgarian church was very close there and very active. And Goce Delchev and all these other revolutionaries who were They went to the Bulgarian church, Bulgarian Exarch Church. And of course, they are promoting also the Bulgarian ethnic identity and so on. It's true that Goce Delchev and some and other these revolutionaries were declaring themselves as Bulgarian, but Bulgarian in that time, we discussed with Sonia, little Bulgarian in that time was not meaning ethnic identity. Bulgarian in that time was meaning the member of the Bulgarian Exarchian Church. But of course, it's very confused for the ordinary people, especially for the politicians. It's a very confused issue. But however, Bulgaria is now saying, come on, we have our history there. The history book have to be changed. The narrative have to be changed and so on. We have to celebrate jointly some holidays and so on. But however, Bulgaria make a very big pressure for now starting the negotiation for this issue. I'm sorry, maybe a little bit. And of course, for Macedonia, it's very hard because now we gave the name of the state. even the ethnicity is not a change, but it's very hard to explain to the people that it's not ethnicity and the name of the state is not the same because of this primordialistic approach that we had from the 19th century, one state, one nation, one language, and so on. And now with this Bulgaria, what is asking is very, very hard issue. According to the document that negotiation document that Macedonia start negotiation, now it's a screening process until the screening will end. We must change now the constitution and to put Bulgarians in a constitution. Actually, the constitution is only the preamble of the constitution. They are mentioning. I said that the constitution is a citizenship state. It's a citizenship. It's not the state of ethnicities. It's, but it also in a public discussion is very big confusion. These minorities who are mentioning, they are thinking also the leaders that they are constitutional part of Macedonia, like in Bosnia. So they, I mean, if they are mentioning, they will be constitutional part. But really, it's very confused, you know. About all these mixing processes, all these ideologies, was going Macedonia. From other side, in this period of the from independence to the, especially from 2009, when Macedonia get visa realization to European Union, we have depopulation of Macedonia. This is going now to the not the Skopje, but the small villages, the small cities. Will have to see their empty villages, half populated cities, especially the cities in the east part of Macedonia and villages where the North Albanians are living in western part. So for example, if you go into Zayas, there is Aljahmeti, Bornor, Kolari. Now in this winter period, you will see thousands of houses, but only two or three houses you will see the light during the night. So they are depopulated totally. So we don't have actually the same population structure that was in 2001 when the From Ohrid framework agreement. Even we had now the census of population 2 years ago, it was a big pressure. We had one also problem in 2011, the census was not successful. It started, but after before the ending of the census, Gruves and Aljahmeti decided the census is failed and we will stop the process. And we didn't have the data from 2002, which was the last census, let's say successful, when that was also very contested. Now in 2022, we had the fresh data for population, the active population. Well, what has also happened? The Albanian political parties, but they do it, they ask also diaspora to be registered and the number of diaspora to be put into the total population. Because we'll see later why, of this adequate and proportional representation in the public bodies. And this is actually the reality. Modern houses and empty villages in Macedonia. Okay. I will not. Okay, let's speak something about the Ohrid framework agreement deeply now. I know what's the time is. How much time you have?
20 minutes.
20 minutes now?
Yeah.
Okay, then we'll go later. What is very important, also one of the processes, this amendment six of the Constitution, where it's guaranteed the adequate legislative representation of citizens belonging to all communities in state authorities and public institutions level. We have also one instrument, which is for us, it's very discriminated, mechanism for discrimination, you know, because the marriage system is not anymore in a power in Macedonia. It's not important when you're employing somebody, is it qualified or not qualified very well? It's important to whom community he or she is belonging. And for that reason, we have this. But we don't have mechanism to really verify the identity of the people. Of course, identity is changeable also. But for example, you will see that the peoples are citizens are declaring differently for different situations. You see, for example, Goran Trajkovski, Albanian. He is declared himself Albanian just to be employed. Or yes, Stalko Serafimovski, because for that position they are actually accepting five, six Albanians or two Turks, one. And when they're fulfilling the application, he's saying that I'm Albanian. Identity is very changeable. So nobody is verifying, it's not possible to verify. But you see how ridiculous the issue we have in this moment. What is goal also here? Yeah, the same examples. And but all these issues from the Ohrid Framework Agreement actually are Albanians are saying they're fulfilled. Macedonians saying thanks God. We fulfill the Ohrid Agreement, but the other minorities say no. We still have to work now for the other communities. But in the Ohrid Framework Agreement, what is also important? It's important the issue of the language. So with Ohrid Framework Agreement, the language of the Albanians also become official language, but it's not staying in constitution the Albanian language. It's staying the language of community which at least 20% of population is speaking. So today can be also the English, because I think more than 30% in Macedonia are speaking English language, but it's not official. And now it's a problem, sure, because the Albanians are concentrated mainly in the west and west north part of Macedonia. Should we also use the Albanian language in Strumica? It's in the eastern part, the southeast part of Ingevgelia, where no Albanian are living. According to the constitution, yes, we have to use, but in the practice, no. And it's a very big problem now about the language issue. We have in the parliament also so-called Badenterian principle. It's been that we, for the laws that are considering the minority rights and multicultural, let's say, politics, it must be double majority. So majority of the member parliaments and majority of the whole communities. Otherwise, will be the veto for the law. Until now, these 20 years, never happened one law to get the veto. And of course, the percent of Albanian employed is drastically growing, even more than the reality we had. Even according to the last census, with diaspora, we have around 30% Albanians, but in practice, in reality, I think there are less 20% Albanians. But as anthropologists, we also following the situation as we know. Okay, this is the last opinion of the Framework Convention, Advisory Committee Framework Convention. The Advisory Committee urges the authorities to take future steps towards the promotion of integrated society that is based on respect and trust between the various communities, to increase the efforts to prevent human rights violating against persons belonging to national minorities, especially the Roma. We still have a big violation to the Roma, and to other smaller communities, and to provide a market assembly of funds at the level that meets the culture, meets and personal international minorities. Because also in the culture, you will see that cultural activities are very, very weak, supported by the government, and most of the money are going to these two big communities. Instead of conclusion, so it's not clear, will Republic of Macedonia in the future develop a sub-ethical democracy or like multicultural, intercultural, inclusive society? It's a really big fight, actually, in academy, political stage, in academic stage, everywhere. The most of the citizens wanted to build a citizen state, intercultural state, but the power has the nationalist. That's the problem. They are not given actually to build. For example, one example, almost 80% of the population to the last survey, they wanted Macedonia to be one electoral unit. But Macedonia is now divided into 6 electoral units and it's promoting this divided society. So with this, for example, with these 6 electoral units, first, the smaller communities, like Turks, for example, they are, or Romas, they are dispersed in the whole state. But, and if they, it was one election union, they will, for sure, they will get 1, 2, 3 members of parliaments without help of the big political parties. But with this division in election union, it's not possible even one Romas to have or Turks to have. But of course, Albanians, they have more than 30 members of parliament because of this election units. And this is one of the, let's say, practical examples why these political nationalist elites, they are keeping and promoting the culture and the citizens wanted intercultural. Macedonia, unfortunately, is the population zone. The last census is not showing the real situation, even we have the results of the census. We have weakened villages, very poor, small cities. So the most of the people, even Macedonia, are living in Skopje, some in Komano and Tetovo, but the other cities are very poor, not functioning, and they have also very big problem. Even we have 80 municipalities, they are not functional municipalities. They are not sustainable municipalities, even they are 80. And now they're discussing again to make the old division during Yugoslavia with 32 municipalities. It was, but it was one trend in 2004 to have 80 municipalities. Every village wanted to have a municipality there. And now they are not sustainable. And we hope that the negotiation process will start. Probably in February, we'll start the procedure for changing constitution. Changing constitution is longing around 3 to 4 months. We will see if we succeeded. At the moment, the parliament, to change the constitution, we need 80 members of parliaments. Until now, we have 72. For sure, who will vote. Again, we need around 8 members of the parliament to vote. Maybe it will be again, like for the Prespa agreement, some political games, some corruption. I don't know how we have to solve. And but of course, it's a very important stage to start the negotiations with the European Union. And I think that when we start the negotiation, this multicultural issue will be improved, and of course, all these other economical and other, let's say, issues. Najlepša hvala. Thank you very much. I hope you have some questions.
Hvala
vidim, da tako bom rekla, zgodovinsko prikazano današnjo situacijo z zgodovinske perspektive. Skratka, lahko smo razumeli, kako bi tako prišlo do današnje Makedonije, kakšna je tudi sestava etnična, kako sprejemajo. Zdaj pa je vprašanje, kolegi, imamo kakšno vprašanje. Prav tako, če ima kdo s kolego, ki nas posluša, lahko se javi.
Samo jedno pitanje. Koji od vaših susjeda je, da tako kažem, najgori? Ili su stvarno to Grci, ili su to Albanci, Srbi ili Bugari?
Ja, je to nagrada se preminuo na srpski ili engleski?
No,
na srpski. But the lady, she understand or not? Ambasador Srbije u Parizu, rani Petar Simić, nažalost je preminuo. Predrag Simić. On je rekao jednom, ja ne bih htio nikad bude Makedonac, a Makedonci imaju najgore susede u svijetu. Pa sad ne znam kako vam kažem, treba da bude neka matrica, neka evolution matrice, pa da to odredimo. Ali mislim da više sa Albanijom i sa Grcijom i sa Srbijom smo rešili probleme. Sa Srbijom je bio problem oko crkve, nisam to stavio, jer posle ovo kad se napravila Jugoslavija, onda Srbija je uzela tu crkvenu parohije sve pod Srpskom pravoslavnom crkvom. I 67. godine Makedonska crkva je uzela autonomiju, posle sama proglasila autokefalnost. U ortodoksnom svetu to je malo kompliciranije da se dobije autokefalnost. Sad se taj problem rešio konačno prije pola godine. Sad bi su dali pravo na autokefalnost. Treba da se još reši u Carigradu. Mislim što se reši vrlo brzo. Problem je rešen. Ja mislim da momentalno sa Bugarima imamo stvarno veliki problem. Identitetski problem je najteži problem da se reši, ja mislim. Ovo drugo teritorija, crkva, ime, ajde tako, ali identitetski problem mislim najteže se reši. A i mislim da još uvek postoji opasnost od takozvane Velike Albanije. Znači ta Velika Albanija kao ideja još živi. Megalo ideje možda u 19. 20. veku koje su se pojavile Velika Grcija, Srbija, znam, Bugarske, tako dalje, sad više ne postoji, ali megalo ideja kod Albanaca još uvijek postoji. I mislim da je to jedna velika realnost i sve ove koje traže da ono bude federalizacija i tako dalje, pošto ako se uvodi albanski jezik sada kao drugi, dakle, je albanski jezik, neki kaže da to je prvi korak prema federalizaciji. Posle federalizacije znate što dolazi. Možda da ne pričamo o tome, da ne prejudiciramo. Ali mislim da veliko-bugarski, veliko-albanski ideje su za Makedoniju najopasniji. Uglavnom su one i bile u Drugom svjetskom ratu kad se podelila, znate, Makedonija od strane fašista. Znači, jedan deo najviše je uzela Italija, odnosno Velika Albanija, da je bila balisti, i najveći deo uzela Bugarska. I, nažalost, te ideje još uvek, nismo mislili se da je to izumrelo, ali se ponovo javilo, pogotovo sad kad je problem sa Bugarskom. Mi se čudimo kako u Bugarskoj još uvek se povampirili neofašistički, da kažem, ideje i ideologije, pa čak iskoristavaju ovaj period kad Makedonija mora da čuti, sve dok ne počnemo pregovore, moramo da čutimo na sve provokacije koje dolaze iz Bugarske. Znači, Bugarski su došli i otvorili su u Bitolju jedan klub po imenu Vančo Mihajlo. Vančo Mihajlo, kako ne znate, on je bio predsjednik VMRO-a i zajedno sa Ante Pavelićem su organizirali atentat kralja, znate, u Marseju. Tada nije bitno za to, ali bitno je da je Vančo Mihajlo bio blizak srodnik sa Hitlerom i sa Ante Pavelićem. I oni su imali tu ideju da, eto, a on se izjašnjavao za Bugarin i on imao tu ideju za vreme kad je bio živ, Makedonija, Švajcarija na Balkanu. A to znači ne po ekonomskom smislu, nego kao Švajcarija što je uređena, ima Nemaca, ima Francuza, ima Italijana, ima vrlo malo ovih retoromana, tako treba bude i Makedonija. Znači ima Bugari, Srbi, Albanci, Grci i to je to tako da se reši makedonsko pitanje, to je njegova teorija. I mislim da pogotovo je bilo ovih strane državnika Bugarske, pogotovo ministarstvo danas je posle Zaharijeve, ona je baš ono najviše bila protiv Makedonije, pa kažu da je Makedonija kreacija Josip Broz Tita, komunista i tako dalje, prije toga je bila Drugovanči, otišla je baš protiv identiteta. Da ne pričam, nekoliko dvoje su europoslanike iz Bugarske, jedan je Kovačev, drugi je, zaboravio sam ime, oni u Europskom parlamentu to ili baš o neofašističke ideologije pričaju i protiv Makedonije. Tako da mislim da su...
Zagovaraju tu teoriju?
Da, da, zagovaraju. I mislim da su da malo organizirani u momentu, tamo je veća opasnost, ali opet ću kažem, možda Albanci sad nisu tako jaki u europskim institucijama, imaju dobar lobby, imaju u Americi i mislim da da to postoji. Tako da opet se povampiruju ili dolaze ta situacija pred drugog svjetskog rata, da se te ideologije, mi kažemo, znate, ideje, ideologije nikad se nasredaju, samo je forma drugačija. Ideje i interesi su veći. Interesi su veći, samo je forma drugačija.
Ja, lepo predavanje ste imali, ja sam se sad sjetio pre 40 godina, bili su dva istoričara iz Makedonije na institutu Ander, mislim, Mira i Sonja, ne su bili mi troje smo tako još tu, koji su pričali kako je demografska situacija, etička situacija u Makedoniji. I tad je meni kao mlado čovjek koji se tek počeo baviti ovim stvarima, pa u oči, znači oni su dali primjer kako je bilo 1920. godine i 1980. godine. Kako je bio procent Albanaca 20. godine, kako je bio 80. A kakav je danas procent Albanaca? Jer je Makedonija još uvijek država Makedonaca ili je to država Makedonaca i Albanaca?
Znači, negdje oko 70. godina Emir Hodža u Albaniji dao je neku instrukciju, to sad imamo te dokumente, za Kosovo i za Bivše Jugoslovenske republike, da Albanci mogu da povrate njihova istorijska područja samo sa demografijom. I oni se počeli da prave po mnogo dece, po 10, 7, 8, šta ja znam. Njihovo pravo, to niko nam se više neša. Ali uglavnom, to je bila neka politika. I stvarno negdje oko 70. i 80. godina imali smo takozvanu demografsku eksploziju. Nekoliko gradova Albanaca su se stvarno brojčno se digli. Ali sad imamo ispražnjavanje. Poslije 2009. godine svi su oni otišli u Švajcarskoj i Nemačkoj, pa i ovdje u Sloveniji imate. Tako da ne može to sa političkim odlukama da se to menadžira i komanduje. Ali sa druge strane, znači ja nisam tu uhvatio, to je problem Torbeša u Makedoniji. Torbeši su po brojnosti treća zajednica u Makedoniji, a to su Makedonci muslimani. Zbog islama, oni ne prihvataju da budu Makedonci, a to što konstrukcija identiteta Makedonaca je jedna od temelja je pravoslavije, ortodoksizam. I oni neće da nemaju puno mešanih brakova pravoslavni ovi Torbeši osoba. A sa druge strane, Albanci preko islamske religije na neki način su uspeli da ih pridobiju. Pa čak smo mimo sela kao što je Labunište, to je tamo u Struškom, jedno veliko, najveće selo u Makedoniji, više od 10.000 ljudi je bilo, sad možda manje zbog iseljavanja. Niko od njih nije znao albanski jezik, ali su da potpisali peticiju da se otvore škole na albanskom jeziku. Što je znači kao Albanci? Tako da nije samo broj sa prirodnim prirastom, da je broj bio i sa politikama. To se desilo i u Plasnici, to se desilo i u Župi, tamo se Turci zašljali i to dalje. Tako da mi imamo još uvijek te etničke procese, mi kažemo, vrlo je to zanimljivo, da nije da oni se izjašnjavaju, normalno ćeš, kako ćeš izjašnjavati, možda zadnje zabraniš, ali onda imamo etnički inženjeri, nije da se njima slobodno izjašnjavaju, tako se osjeća, nego imamo inženjeri, neko im to kaže, neko im da neke benefite, pogotovo ovo što je sa procentom zapošljavanja Albanaca, da se broj digne, veliki broj torbeša se izjašnjavaju Albanci da bi se zaposlili, to je normalna stvar. Tako da, to kažem, mi etnolozi imamo drugu sliku, jel mi gledamo i kulturu, da li pripadaš u zajednici, jel jedna identiteta, druga da li pripadaš. Ja mogu se sjećati da sam Kines, ali ako ne pripadam u toj zajednici, ne znam što ja znam kineski jezik, ne znam običaj kineska, nisam Kines, ali se izjašnjavam kao Kines. E to je možda najveći problem kod svih nas u liberalnoj demokratiji, da mi uvažavamo identitet, a ne uvažavamo pripadnost. E to možda je možda jedan od većih problema u Europi, da.
Prije ste pomenuli ovaj klub negdje u Makedoniji, bugarski klub.
Da.
Čuo sam i za druge.
Da,
koji su,
tri.
Koji imaju imena bugarskih nacionalista ili
fašista,
kralja i tako. Pa to je sve dozvoljeno ili makedonska država komentira nešto protiv toga? To je jedan samo komentar, drugo je koliko ima li procjene u Makedoniji koliko ljudi je preuzelo bugarsko državljanstvo zbog EU i drugih razloga.
Da, do sad su dva kluba se otvorili, jedan u Bitoli, jedan u Ohridu. Normalno Ohrid je za njih Jerusalim, oni kažu da je Ohrid bugarski, mi kažemo da je balkanski Jerusalim, ali vrlo je bitno bilo za njih ovo. I tamo su otvorili klub kralja Borisa III. Ili drugog, ne znam, onaj koji je potpisao trojni pak sa Hitlerom i koji je nažalost odvio negdje oko 20.000 Jevreja u Treblinki. Da. Znači, on je imao neku politiku, u Bugarskoj Jevreje je sačuvao, ali u Traki Makedoniji sve Jevreje je ovdje od Treblinki i to je jedan dokaz da to nije njihova teritorija, jer ja lako mogu da osjećam vašu ruku, a moju ruku neću da osjećam. Tako da, ali nažalost, oni su otvorili tu klub, kulturni klub, znači nikad nije bavio kulturom, ali kulturni klub se zove. Ja sam jednom komentirao, skomili ste Josip Rostita iz glavne ulice u Ohridu, se zove Kejmaršal Tito, evo vam sad moram za Trečak. Tako da, sa stara je država. Nije bilo, znači svako udruženje koje se registrira po centralnom registru, znači Makedonija je jedini prvak u svijetu po registraciji pravnih subjekata. Znači odmah vam registriraš u centralni registar, bilo šta, firmu, udruženje i tako dalje. Tu smo baš bila to istraživanje, prvi smo u svijetu za to. Znači za jedan dan, dva registriraš. Nije problem kod nas, samo da ispuniš sve to što se traži.
Digitalizacija,
da. I znači nije bilo zakonskog mogućnosti da se to spreči, se registrira. Sad se nešto donelo u parlamentu, neki zakon, da za neke, kad se spominje neke ličnosti, da mora neka komisija za pravde da da neko mišljenje. Kad se stavi neko ime od nekog istorijske figure. Tako da, ali i stavio se da to bude i retroaktivno, sad mogu da ispita, ako neko sad podnose ovo predstavku, može da se preispita da li ovo, da se ukine to udruženje. I u svakom slučaju u ustavu postoji da je zabranjena bilo koja diskriminacija i poticaj rasne, etničke interpeljivosti, ako ti afirmiraš Borisa III. Onda ti protiv Jevreja u Makedoniji ti afirmiraš rasnu diskriminaciju tako, i netrpeljivost. Tako da to je to. Ali, znate šta, Bugari vrlo sada igraju, iskoristavaju ovaj moment, dok ne počnemo realno, dok zavljaju screening, ne počnemo realno pregovore. Provociraju, prilično ima velikih provokacija, ali ne svi, kažemo, ja imam dosta prijatelja, ja sam doktorirao u Bugarskoj, imam dobre prijatelje, u Bugarskoj se reagira na toj intelektualci, reagiraju što se dešava, ali elita tamo politička je politička elita, oni imaju njihove interese. iako intelektualci su prilično korektni u Bugarskoj. Ovako, dosta ima i koji su izašli sa dobrim kolumnama, ali to je to.
A imate Bugari nešto sa digitalizacijom? Jer je i nova ministrica za digitalizaciju Slovenije je iz Makedonka.
A, da. Izdelčeno, odakle. Izbjero.
Ja, ampak jaz da lahko samo mislim, da to sem potela prašati. Ali imate podatke? Razumete slovensko?
Slovensko filoski su vrlo mjesti.
Ali imate podatke koliko študentov, to se pravi, odhaja iz Makedonije študirati v Bulgarijo? Kajti, po mojih informacijah, prav jih je dokaj veliko, kajti iz Bulgarije, diploma iz Bulgarije omogoča v bistvu prosti pretok po vsej EU, ne, ker je, ne, to se pravi, je lažje in da veliko, veliko Makedoncev se odloči prav za to študirati v Bulgariji, zato da potem lahko grejo v evropske države. To obstoje kakšne številke, ali je to problem, ali to, kako to jemljete, prednost, problem?
Prvo ovo pitanje, pitanje se koliko pasoša, da ne zaboravim. Znači, bugarski zastav se nekako 200.000 pasoša izdala u Makedoniji, a znači kad tamo daju ti ni pasoš, ti potpunjaš nju izjavu na notar da prihvataš da imaš bugarski proizvod, ali ovo poreklo. Ali na popisu se nisu toliko izjasnili u Makedoniji. Oko 3.000 su izjasnili. 3.000 je uvijek bilo Bugara, otprilike, istorijski. A sad ovo pitanje, da, veliki je interes studenata iz Makedonije da studiraju u Sloveniji. Nažalost, univerziteti u Makedoniji sve više padaju, kvalitet pada, broj im pada. I ja sam bio u jednom univerzitetu, ja čak i vodio sam, ali više nije ekonomsko padano se da vodiš univerzitet. Ne samo zbog toga, možda i zbog toga što u Makedoniji je velika korupcija. Vrlo lako može kupiš diplomu u Makedoniji. Sad je afera ispala zadnja, sin predsjednika parlamenta, tada Džaferija, su našli da je položio pravosudni ispit, a nije imao diplomu. Dakle, sve i svašta ima. Ali zašto je problem? Ovi studiraju, da, zalažu se, a pošto može da se zaposli. A ovi koji ne studiraju, kupe diplomu i samo zaposle. Zbog toga koji imamo taj rankovni ugovor koji smo pričali i okvirni ugovor. Uglavnom, da, postoji jedan trend u Makedoniji da što pre ideš da radiš u Evropu. Najveći uspeh u Makedoniji je da izađeš iz Makedonije, da radiš gdje van, zbog diskriminacije, zbog nemogućnosti da se dobro uposliš, zbog ekonomske perspektive i tako dalje. Tu nema diversity, svi su tu isti jednaki. Zbog toga Slovenija, mislim da sad ima najbolje politike za makedonske studente da dođu tu. Mislim da je i besplatno studiranje, tako u Sloveniji. Za Makedoniju.
Da.
Da. I mislim da prilično ima dosta studenata. Imamo dosta ljudi koji rade od Jugoslavije ovdje, dosta biznismena koji rade. Tako da, to je to, Slovenija je za Makedoniju neka vrata, najbliža vrata, da, eto, da lakše i bolje žive. A sa drugim sami mislim da i Slovenija ima potrebe, nic za takve kvadrove. I to je to. Ja lično ne smatram da je to problem. Sam ulazak u Evropsku uniju znači da je mobilnost da bude na velikoj razini. Kod nas to gledaju već kao problem, depopulacija, deo ovo. Ali, eto, sad su komunikacije globalno ono selo u funkciji, mobilizacija je dobra i kvalitet je dobar. Ja mislim da oni se ne iseljavaju za uvek, oni opet dolaze, rade, ulaže. Za Makedoniju to je dobro, to je to, vidjeli se da je fotografije, savremene kuće, tehnologija se donosi nova, ovi koji investiraju, to se tamo nose novu ideologiju, novu tehnologiju. To je to, razvoj je uvek. Čak kad je Marko Polo bio u Kini, pa kad se vratio i bio neki progres. Pa smo dobili šta? Renesansu, tako je. Kasnije, ako je plazo nije. Ali kad uvek ima neke relacije i promjena, da je dobro.
Možda samo ako možeš nešto malo više da objasniš
o konceptu jednog društva za aha. sve. Mislim da bi toliko bilo da. Dobro da se spomneš.
Dobro, to što možemo se pohvalimo je da Makedonija je prva zemlja u Evropi koja je napravila strategiju za interkulturalizam. Ona se usvojila negde u januaru 2020. Nažalost, COVID je počeo odmah u februaru i sve to što se planiralo u akcijnom planu nije moglo se implementirati zbog COVID pandemije koja je trajala više od godinu i po dana, sve je bilo blokirano, znate i mi stvarni. Ali nešto, barem u zakonodavstvu se nešto promenilo. E sad, ta strategija jedno društvo ima 7 klastera. Jedan klaster je bio ovo pravni okvir da se podobri legislativa i da se ona uhodi što pre sa europskim sa kvizom oko borbu protiv diskriminacije i ovo socijalne kohezije i interkulturalizma. Drugi klaster je bio obrazovanje. Znači, najveći problem i obrazovanje i u Makedoniji su verovatni suda. U Makedoniji je prilično veliki problem i naš cilj je bio da ne samo promovišemo da se uči jezik zajednicu, da se pojačaju interkulturne kompetencije. Tu smo još uvijek nemamo uspeh, uspeh možda se vidi možda poslije 10-15 godina, ali stvar je u tome da deca mogu da uče više jezika još od obrazovanja. Nažalost, to divajac society je da deca, Makedonci, Albanci, šta ja znam i drugi, od obdaništa do fakulteta uče na svoj jezik i nigde se ne susreću. Znači, on završi na albanski, na makedonski jezik i on uopšte nije upoznao dece od druge zajednice, a posle poče da radi. I treba da radi na šalteru u opštini i on ne zna makedonski jezik. E tu je problem. I zbog toga smo rekli, ajde da pravimo te interkulturne kompetencije da razvijamo. Programe, sirikulme treba da menjamo i tako dalje. Polako i to ide, nije lak posao i to. Prilično je složen posao. Treći klaster je bio, što jeste, klaster kultura. Nažalost, Makedonija u taj divide society u kulturi je prilično podržavala i finansirala samo etnocentrične projekte. Znači, šta ja znam, folklorno društvo Vlaha, emisija na turski jezik, publika, knjige na bosanski. Čak smo imali 2 sajma knjige posebnih. Jedan za albanski, jedan za makedonsko izdavaštvo. Katastrofa. Mesto da sajam knjige bar bude neki zajednički, centralni, 2 sajma knjige posebno je bilo. Tako da, stavili smo neke sad u tom klasteru odrednice, instrukcije, pravilnike, da se što više promovira interkulturalizam, a ne samo, da kažemo, iako nije takva stroga podelja multi i interkulturalizam, ali etnocentrizam se ne pomoće, nego se pomoće interkulturalizam. Naredni klaster je mladi. Ne znam, kod vas sigurno i vi imate ovih navijača, huligana, ali kod nas to huliganstvo ide na etnocentrizam i šovinizam. Znači, tamo kad igraju jedan makedonski, jedan makedonsko-albanski futbolski klub, onda to je katastrofa, to je kao ratno stanje. Tako da, i bilo je sad, je zadnji utakmica, je bilo prilično specijalne sile, ali govor mržnje, to je strašno nešto. Znači, ja uopšte, moj sin je sad 15 godina, ja ne mogu da vodi na publici, da sluša taj govor mržnje, da se truje tamo. Tako da, ja normalan čovjek ne može da ide na utakmicu. I htjeli smo da ne sam utakmič, nego bilo gde sa mladim politikama, bilo je vrlo puno tuča u autobusima u Skopju, Albanci, Makedonci, pa bila tuča jedna velika tamo kod tvrđave u 2015. godine. Tako da htjeli smo da malo više radimo sa mladim ljudima i da taj govor može kod mladi da suspendujemo. Onda naredni klaster je lokalna samouprava, jer to je pravi suživot na lokalnom nivou, nije na nacionalnom nivou, nije u parlamentu. U parlamentu se super slažu poslanici, nije problem i u vladi, ali na lokalnom nivou je vrlo teško, a pravi multikulturalizam i interkulturalizam treba da se odbija na lokalnom nivou, ali problem je što to ministarstvo lokalne samouprave nema ingerencije na tim lokalnim, da kažem, samoupravima i svaka opština je posebna priča. Tu je najveći sad problem, ovaj sad naredni klaster, predložetak strategije, tu ćemo se malo više koncentrisati, tako je predlog. Onda smo imali socijalnu koheziju, još jedan klaster, jer politike socijalne koheziju uopće nije bilo. Sve ove zajedne interesorske, da kažemo, politike na neki način treba da se usuglase. Makedonija ima 8 razvojnih regiona, ali ti regioni nisu podjednako razvijeni. U primjeru Skopje, GDP per capita možda je, šta znam, 700-800 eura, mesečna plata, da kažemo, znači nije per capita, ili ja da kažemo, nekde oko 5000 euro je u Skopje per capita GDP, a tamo u Delčevo Berovo je 1500. I, znači nije podjednako razvijen, pa a što što kohezno zavisi najviše tog lokalnog regionalnog razvoja. To su klasteri, nažalost, dobro prihvaćene od građana, dobro prihvaćene od međunarodne zajednice, i najveću podršku, ali od samih političara i vlada koja je to promovisala, da svaki način je ovih 3 godine gledala da to nekako eskivira. Iako se promovišu, svuda idu, pričaju ministri naši, jedno društvo za sve, interkulturalizam, dobiju nagrade međunarodne, kitaju se pre, ali ako ja samo kažem da vlada nije dala za ovih 3 godine za strategiju ni jedan denar, sve je to finansirala međunarodna zajednica do sada i mislim da je to problem. Sad mi, eto, dobro sam je pitao Mikija, mi sad imamo evaluaciju ovoga i treba pravimo novu strategiju. I jedno od razmišljenja je da mi treba da uzimo ekskluzivitet te strategije od vlade. Da vlada učestvuje tu, ali da nije glavno, nego da bude neki steering committee sa međunarodnom prisutstvom tamo, što oni daju pare na kraju, ne daju vlade ništa, ali da vlada implementiše to. Kako ćemo to da uspemo, ne znam. Sad bi baš taj proces evaluacije. Ali je dobro da postoji volja. Znači, prva volja, ja kad sam otišao jedan u Mađarsku i tamo pokazao strategiju nekim od ovih profesora tamo, pokazao super, nikad nisam vidjeli ovo, znači Mađari ne razmišljaju o ovakvim stvarima, ali eto, u Makedoniji bar postoje neka počva ideja da se to razvije, ali to je opet što kaže, Mić je dobro napisao recenziji, nacionalčovinisti to teško dozvoljavaju da se to u potpuno će sprovede. Mislim da ima još nešto, ne znam, o strategiji. Ali dobro je da to strategija ima dobre volje. Kako ćemo dalje, vidjet ću.
Ja se
je
tudi to dobro za
začetnje.
Sad dobre volje, ne? Samo dobre volje do nekega trenutka, ne?
Da.
Ne potrebno da se to tudi realizira. A imaš je bilo kakšno vprašanje? Kdo še ena, mogoče kdo izmed kolegov, ki posluša?
Ne vidim ruku.
Ne. Skratka.
Svi so nam ljud.
Ne govorijo.
Nema ne ruk.
Ja, nema rukice. Mislim, da je bilo tako izčrpno in tako, bom rekla, pedagoško dobro pripravljeno, da smo razumeli. Ne? Tudi marsikatere stvari, ki niso bile direktno, so nas pa spodbudile, da razmišljamo tudi o malo drugačni stvari. Jaz bi se kolego Rubino najlepše zahvalila. En kratek aplavz, res hvala. Dolgih letih od našega, bom rekla, znanstva prišel na inštitut in, bom rekla, predstavil in jaz si obetam tudi nadaljne sodelovanje. Na različnih področjih, tako tukaj imamo kolege, tudi ki se ukvarjajo s tematikami, smo resnično tak interdisciplinarni tim, tako da naše sodelovanje seveda se ne bo končalo samo v okviru mreže oziroma v okviru predavanja, ampak tudi lahko še poglobljeno. Hvala, Rubin, in upamo, da se še kdaj vidimo.
Hvala i vama puno. Nadam se, da se ranije produžimo. Ja vas pozivam, kod nas ima puno i konferencije, i letnih škola, imamo sad u januari na konferenciju, baš na pitanju, pa doćete slobodno, učestvujete, možete preko Zuma, da što više o to razmenimo znanje.
Sharing of knowledge. Sharing of knowledge. Yeah, this is the most important thing. Yes. Sharing of knowledge and having the dialogue. And most, of course, you know, I think that this strategy for multiculturalism, it should be implemented not only in Macedonia, but I think everywhere, also in Europe. Even if it is written somewhere, but not realized.
Yes. Yes.
Hvala lepa.
Hvala lepa.
In to je vse. Hvala. Če pa imate kolegi, lepo še tudi individualno, kakršno koli vprašanje. Hvala.
Hvala.